About a year ago, we had the opportunity to attend an excellent seminar in Annapolis put on by the U.S. Sailing Association. The seminar is titled Safety at Sea. They offer several different tracks. You can do a coastal or a near-coastal course. You can do an offshore course. I can't recommend the seminar enough. For those of you that may want to revisit your safety procedures, safety checklists, things to do in case of an emergency, things to do when you're sailing in heavy weather. What I want to share with you today is a couple of videos that I shot during that seminar. This is just a teaser video to kind of show you a couple demonstrations that they did for us. The first two clips are man overboard procedures. You'll hear Chuck Hawley in the background narrating the events as they happen. He is the chairman of the Safety at Sea Committee for U.S. Sailing. I'll provide the links to the Safety at Sea seminar in the video description. The first clip will show a figure eight maneuver, which is a non-jibing maneuver, and they're going to use an elevator recovery. The second procedure is going to be a single-handed maneuver, and to retrieve the man overboard, captain will be using a 3-to-1 lifting tackle and halyard on a winch. The third clip is a demonstration by the U.S. Coast Guard of a helicopter rescue at sea. Again, these are all just teasers. I hope you enjoy, and I hope you'll think about attending the Safety at Sea seminar, and I will include the links in the description below.
Louisville, Kentucky. So this is going to be a modified figure eight. The figure eights we used to do 25 or 30 years ago consisted of man overboard and then bearing off to what amounted to a beam reach and sailing away from the victim for sometimes 30 to 60 seconds and then coming back on a reciprocal course. And the problem was you just sailed too far away from the victim. What the Naval Academy has done is come up with a faster, shorter method, which requires an initial tack. So you have to have crew members that are ready to tack the boat when the person goes in the water. And it shortens the distance sailed away from the victim. Okay, here they go hard on the wind. Person was in the water. You can hear the skipper giving clear commands to the crew, tacking, and they're going to bear off. The reason they're going to bear off to such a deep reach is because they've got to get to leeward of the victim to make their approach. There's your pointer. So they're going to run downwind. And as was said earlier, John Tansky mentioned that if you haven't thrown a flotation on the first pass, they're actually going right past them on the downwind leg. This is another opportunity to throw a flotation. Now somebody's going to say, well, why don't they just pick them up now? It's really difficult to stop the boat. So they're going to sail past them. This would be more obvious if we had more wind. Come back on the second pass. This is also a non-jibing maneuver. So the makes it good for heavy wind conditions. A lot of people don't like to jibe in heavy wind. There the jib goes across. Now they're going to come back around. In this light air, they're going to probably make a fairly gentle circle so they don't kill off the boat speed. Sails are really inefficient at this point because they're strapped in. Notice they have been, except for taking the jib across, they have not been tended at this point. Having the main strapped in makes it inefficient, makes the boat go slowly, which reduces the distance they sail away from the victim. Now attacking again. They can do this either with the jib up or the jib down. In this case, it looks like they're going to drop the jib on this final approach. Mm-hmm. This particular recovery is going to be the elevator recovery. This is something we learned about in San Francisco Bay in about 2005. I'm not saying it was invented there, but it's the first time I'd seen it demonstrated. The idea is you put a line over the side that runs back to a cockpit winch. You have the person who's in the water stand in the bite of the line. And as soon as they're sort of stabilized and they have their feet in the bite of the line, you grind them up. So let's take a look at how this is being done. Notice the heaving line's used again. The person in water may have to hang on for just a second while the boat slows down. You actually want to be able to stand in the line, put your hands against the side of the hull or get a little help, and then grind them up. And you want to get the person back on board as soon as you can. So people tend to rush and they leave out steps and they take shortcuts, and you shouldn't do that. The instructions, if you use a life, a man overboard. Okay, she's got a cushion in the cockpit, that's great. Starts bringing the boat up into the wind. Now this does two things. It shortens the distance that she's sailing away from the victim. But it also slows down the boat. So that now everything's kind of slowing down. She's gone from going 4 or 5 knots at boat speed, maybe down to 2 or 2.5 knots. She reaches into the bag, pops out the life sling and the life sling strobe light. This is going to pay out of the bag. Notice she's not dealing with the line at all. It's just going to pay out of the bag, just as I was demonstrating on stage earlier. Turns down wind. Since she's single-handed, doesn't have a furling jib, she leaves both sails up, not a problem. Again, the jibe is very gentle, especially when it's blowing 5, but even if it were blowing harder, the jibe would be very gentle. She's going to go to leeward of the person in the water and drag the life sling line to him. One of the things that we learned in our San Francisco Bay trials was that it was very nice to have the person in the water would say, "Hey, when you told me you saw me going overboard, it made me feel a lot more confident." So you can actually shout words of encouragement to the person in the water, like, "I see you, I've got you, I'm coming back to get you." And it is, it's really reassuring. Even if you're failing, it's still good. Okay, so the line has almost gotten to the person in water. He's going to kind of scooch over there a little bit to speed things up. You would too if you were immersed in the river right now. And as soon as he has it in his control, she's going to stuff the boat up into the wind, bring the boat to a stop. She can actually go into a hove to position right now, but really what she wants to do, if he's got the line, she wants to stop the boat and to start hauling him in. What would happen if the line never got to the victim at this point? Well, she just continues circling. Not a problem, because she can circle endlessly with the sails in this sail trim. Now she's going to turn the helm into the wind a little bit, and in doing so, get into this kind of quiet hove to position, and she's going to start striking sails. Jib comes down. One of the things it's important to do is to try to get as much sail area off of the boat as you can. If the jib doesn't come down easily because of the halyard stuck or something, it's really a problem because the boat will start sailing away from the victim. Notice now she's going to take him on the weather side, hauling him in hand over hand. She's going to use a 3-to-1 lifting tackle, which has been hauled up or will be hauled up on an extra halyard. If you don't have an extra halyard, you can use a jib halyard, you can use the main halyard, you can use a spinnaker halyard, you can use any halyard you have. It doesn't have to be on one side of the shrouds or another. There she drags him along. At this point, she would normally want to make him fast to the side of the boat and get as much of his body out of the water as possible so that she can reduce his hypothermic heat loss. In this case, he's wearing a survival suit. He's probably good for another 10 minutes or so, at least. Okay, now she's getting the halyard ready. And she's going to take the halyard that she's using, and she's going to haul this block and tackle up in the air. And we're going to, you'll see how high she has to haul the fiddle block in order to ensure that he can go get all the way on deck. You can see the blue line there. She's going to run it out. There's no tension on it because she's just kind of stretching out the tackle. And she wants it 10 feet off the deck. This is a great time, if you're going to use a consistent halyard, to mark the halyard so you know how high to haul it up. Basically, it has to be way over your head. Now she's taking the fall from the tackle through a snatch block. Actually, she's dropping down the tackle to the victim so he can snap himself in. She's going to take this down through any sort of deck fairly and run it back to a big self-tailing winch. In this case, she's using a secondary winch on the cabin top. Gets the handle in. Starts grinding about. The 3-to-1 tackle makes really any winch strong enough to pull somebody out of the water. It takes a little bit longer. You can see where that single block that's above his head is located. You can also see that if you have the fiddle block that has been hoisted aloft too low to the deck, you won't get back on deck before you two block it. So it's really important to do a Megan's done here, and he did it way off the deck. And you can see he's helping himself a little bit, but she's doing all the work. Excellent job.